Hello, David Diga Hernandez here, and welcome to Spirit Church. Today, I'm talking about 9 divine tests that God will test you through before He promotes you to the next level in ministry, in life, in blessing. Before God will bless you, He will test you. And we're going to look at the life of Joseph and discover what these 9 divine tests are. But right now, Stephen Moctezuma is here. He's going to lead us in some worship.
You made a way for me to enter the holy place. You made a way for me to enter the holy place. You made a way. You to enter the holy place, you made a way. You made a way for me to enter the holy place. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. More of you, for you made a way. Jesus, Jesus, we sing you made a way. You made a way for me to enter the holy place. You made a way for me to enter the holy place.
So today I'm going to be talking about passing divine tests. Really, the Lord wants to take you to the next level in your ministry. He wants to take you to the next level in the anointing in which you walk. He wants to take you to the next level in life, in your relationships, in your goals. Some of you have been blessed with businesses. God wants to help you get to the next level in business. Whatever God has blessed you with, you can grow and receive more and be responsible over more as you learn to pass divine tests. We're going to be looking at the life of Joseph, and we're actually going to be looking at a lot of scripture today. So go to Genesis chapter 37, and we're going to be going through more scripture than usual in Spirit Church, but I think that's a plus here. And I want to talk to you about why God will promote someone or why God will increase the power on someone's life. And really, I understand that in Christ we have all things, that in Christ we've received everything, that when He died and gave His life, that He sacrificed once and for all to give us everything that we need to live the Christian life. And I'm not saying that God will reward what I would call a faction of the spiritually elite, if ever there was such a faction. I'm simply saying that God will give you larger influence. God will allow you to see greater miracles. God will take you to more places. God will allow you to touch more lives. As you are faithful in the little, the scripture tells us that God gives us more. And so I'm talking about 9 divine tests that God will put you through, that we at least see here in the life of Joseph. Now, I'm not saying that these are all the tests that God has, but certainly these are ones that I've experienced in my own life and Joseph actually experienced in his. Now, it's amazing to me that people talk about going through circumstances in their lives and they look at it like a negative thing, when the scripture says that everything that we go through works perseverance and ultimately helps to build our faith and mature us spiritually as we go through these certain issues. And I believe that God will do more in opposition. God will do more in your pain than He'll do through almost anything else. So the life of Joseph we see in Genesis 37. Let's go ahead and read Genesis chapter 37, verse 1 through 11 first. And this is what the scripture says. So Jacob settled again in the land of Canaan, where his father had lived as a foreigner. This is the account of Jacob and his family. When Joseph was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flocks. He worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpah. But Joseph reported this to his father, some bad things his brothers were doing. Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe. But his brothers hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. They couldn't say a kind word to him. One night, Joseph had a dream. And when he told his brothers about it, they hated him more than ever. So I want you to try to imagine this. Already in this home, there is some tension around the relationship regarding Joseph and his brothers and his father, because Jacob has favor for Joseph as demonstrated by the coat of many colors that he had given to him as a gift. Now, if you have the favor of God upon your life, you're going to stand out among the rest. Not only are you going to stand out among the rest as blessed because your father loves you and has favor on you, but people will often come to hate you because of the blessing that you carry, because of the favor that you carry. The further you go in the favor of God, the further you go in the blessing of God, the more God rewards you, the more people will hate you for what God has given to you because they don't have it. Now, I'm of the belief that anyone can become a favored person of God so long as they obey what he does. The scripture tells us that favor can be acquired through obedience. Favor can be acquired through pleasing God, and faith pleases God. So there are many ways in which you can become favored of God, and that's a totally different lesson for a different time. But we see that Joseph does have this distinguishing mark of the favor of his father placed upon him in the form of a robe of many colors, a coat of many colors. And so his brothers dislike him. His brothers are jealous. His brothers can see, obviously, that their father has a favor on their brother. And this makes it so much worse because the scripture says, go to verse 5, Genesis 37, 5. One night Joseph had a dream. And when he told his brothers about it, they hated him more than ever. Wait till you hear the dream. The dream goes like this. Listen to this dream, he said. We were out in the field tying up bundles of grain. Suddenly, my bundle stood up, and your bundles all gathered around and bowed low before mine. Now, can you imagine in the middle of all that tension? Here we see Joseph presenting a dream that basically has the implications of his brothers bowing before him as their ruler. Verse 8. His brothers responded, "So you think you will be our king, do you? Do you actually think you will reign over us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dreams and the way he talked about them. That verse jumped right out at me. It says they hated him all the more because of his dreams and the way he talked about them. Have people ever hated you for the way you talked about your dreams? Have they ever become jealous? Have they ever become hateful? Have they ever become disdainful toward you because of the dream that God has given you? You may say it and they may misunderstand you and what you're trying to do. And then to make matters a little more tense, verse 9 tells us, soon Joseph had another dream. And again, he told his brothers about it. Listen, I have had another dream, he said. The sun, moon, and 11 stars bowed low before mine. This time he told the dream to his father as well as to his brothers, but his father scolded him. What kind of dream is that? He asked. What will your mother and I and your brother actually come and bow to the ground before you? But while his brothers were jealous of Joseph, his father wondered what the dreams meant. The first test you will go through when God has called you, when God has placed a dream upon you, when God has spoken to you, when God has given you something special, the first test you will go through is the test of being misunderstood. Do not expect everyone to celebrate the call of God on your life. Do not expect everyone to celebrate the dream that He has given you. In fact, when you have the favor of God, expect that people will become jealous, that people will become hateful, that people will misunderstand you. You know, I remember one time I was attending a conference, and this conference was a gathering of several pastors from all over the world, and we were coming to hear the Word of God. I was very excited to attend this conference. And this was maybe about a year or so after I had started in television, and news got around that I was doing television ministry. And, you know, as that spread the first time, some people, you know, they were happy that we were reaching more people with the gospel, because that's really the heart behind the matter. Other people would talk down on it, and I never really listened to the critics anyway. But I remember I went to this conference, and I was so excited to hear the word. I saw a seat down open in the front. I said, awesome, I'm going to go sit down. And I remember I had my notepad and everything. I'm sitting down and I'm listening to the speaker. I enjoyed the conference. It was powerful. God spoke to me. I was refreshed. And as I'm getting up and I'm leaving to go to the back of the room, which is the exit, a pastor comes up to me and goes, oh, yeah, I see you in the front trying to sit up there to get all the attention. And I said, okay, well, maybe it was wrong of me to go and sit in the front. Maybe this time I'll go and sit somewhere else. So the next night, I decided I'm going to sit in the back of the church service. This way I don't draw any attention, or no one thinks that I'm trying to draw any attention. And so I sat in the back, still had my notepad, still had my Bible, and I was excited to see what God was doing. God spoke to me. I was refreshed again. And I'm getting ready to leave. And as I'm leaving, a different pastor comes up to me. He goes, oh, so you're sitting in the back, huh? You think you're so popular that you have to hide. And I thought, well, I guess there's really no pleasing anybody. No matter what I do, if I have the favor, if I'm blessed of God, no matter what I do, no matter where I go, I'm going to be misunderstood. Let me tell you something, and I hope this liberates you. You do not have to explain yourself to your critics. I don't know how many times I've been accused of being arrogant, of being prideful, of being, I mean, you name it, I've been accused of it. And I don't know where most of this stuff comes from. I guess some people misunderstand my persona. But for the most part, I don't even bother with critics. In fact, all I know is that I focus my eyes on Jesus. I seek to obey him. Sure, I have people around me who, if I were to get out of line, they would tell me. I have good friends like Steve here, who I guarantee you, Steve, would you have any trouble correcting me if I was out of line? No. Not at all, right? No. I surround myself with good friends. I have great pastors, and that you should do. But when it comes to trying to explain yourself to everybody, listen, you're going to go crazy trying to please everyone and trying to get everybody to see you in the way you want to be seen. Not everyone is going to look at you or view you in a positive light. In fact, when you have the favor of God, those who are experiencing turmoil in their life will look at you and be highly critical of you because they don't have what you have. But I want to tell you this, that's the first test you will go through, is you will be misunderstood. People will question your motives. People will question your persona. People will question even how you come across. Everything about you will be questioned when you step into the destiny that God has for you. Whatever it may be that God placed on your heart, the first test is being misunderstood. The issue with being misunderstood only arises if you allow it to give you power over you. I encourage you today to pass this test. You simply keep your eyes on Jesus. Second, go to chapter 37. We're going to read now just a few verses, verse 12 through 14. This is what the scripture says. Soon after this, Joseph's brothers went to pasture their father's flocks at Shechem. When they had been gone for some time, Jacob said to Joseph, "Your brothers are pasturing the sheep at Shechem. Get ready, and I will send you to them." "I'm ready to go," Joseph replied. "Go and see how your brothers and the flocks are getting along," Jacob said. "Then come back and bring me a report." So Jacob sent him on his way, and Joseph traveled to Shechem from their home in the valley of Hebron. Now, number two is the test of service. You see, even though God had given Joseph a dream, even though Joseph knew by divine revelation that he would one day be of influence to the point where his father, his mother, and his brothers would all bow before him, he was still willing to serve. We see the same thing about King David. King David tended sheep before he was king. And I believe it was in the worship when tending to sheep that King David received the power that he needed to overthrow Goliath and the various oppositions that came his way. God will allow you to serve, and it is a privilege to serve no matter which capacity, to what capacity it's in. God will allow you to serve as a test to see where your heart is. Service comes before those who are about to be promoted. So my encouragement to you, the only way you can pass the test of service is if, despite the favor of God, despite the vision that he has given you, despite the dreams that he has placed in your heart, the only way you're going to pass that test is if you stay humble. I don't think there's anything that God hates more than pride. The scripture says that God resists the proud. Think about that. God resists them, actively pushes them away, but he gives grace to the humble. Now, humility is a misunderstood trait altogether, I think. A lot of people think that humility has to do with self-degradation or self-criticism. I don't think humility is self-criticism at all. Humility doesn't deny that a gift has been given, but humility acknowledges the source of that gift. So you don't have to criticize yourself. You don't have to look at yourself in a negative light to be humble. You simply have to recognize your position and that everything you have is because of what God has done, and that everything you have is because of the mercy of God, and that everything you have is despite the fact that we've messed up. That's how you pass the test of service, is you remain humble and you do the things that some people would disdain or would look lowly upon. Do those things. If you do what's before you, promotion will come from the Lord. You know, I don't understand how people think that they could move on to the next place in ministry if they haven't been humbled. I was listening to my brother minister a sermon this past week, and he said something to the effect of this, and it was really powerful. He said something to the effect of this. He said, some of you are upset because someone else is getting promoted over you, and you're saying, why hasn't God promoted me? And then my brother said, well, it's that very attitude that keeps you from being promoted. It's that very perspective. It's that lack of humility. It's that pride. It's that ego. It's that drive. It's that ambition that keeps you down. God will exalt the humble, and he'll humble the exalted. This is the test of service. We cannot think that we're going to the next level, the next step, the next anything, if we have not passed our test. You know, I remember for me, it was quite an ordeal to get my driver's license. I had this phobia of cars. Many of you who've read my books know my issues with anxiety that I used to battle real heavily. And I just had this anxiety when it came to driving cars. And I must have gone to take the test. Okay, first of all, the first three times I went to even go into the test, the people didn't show up that were supposed to let me use their car. In fact, one of them is sitting behind the camera that I'm looking at right now. But all is forgiven, all is forgiven. But anyway, so I had three different people try to take me. Each person, there was three different people, because I didn't have a car, and I had said, hey, can you let me use your car, take me to it? I worked it out. Three different people, three separate occasions, did not show up on time or just didn't show up altogether. I won't say who that was, even though that person may be operating a camera here right now. But finally, the fourth time I get in, I was like, yes, okay, now I have a vehicle. I'm actually taking it in, and I failed the test. Then the next time I went, I believe it was the fifth time I went in, I failed the test again. And I forgot how many times, and I don't know if I got the exact number, but I remember it felt like so many times. And I remember one of the times I went in, the time before I passed the test and got my license, I actually caused an accident. So it was not at all an enjoyable experience for me. I still remember to this day, because I saw a pedestrian as turning right, and I saw a pedestrian coming off of the curb, and I thought the person was going to walk, and I had the green light to go straight ahead. So I stopped thinking the pedestrian was going to cross. And sure enough, like three cars back, there was an accident because I stopped on the green light, and the instructor said, go, 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 I'm not here, just go. And I don't remember what happened to that instructor, but we parked, and then he took off and said, you're on your own, and left me. So that's how that ended. I don't know what was up with that instructor. But it would have been odd if I had passed after having failed so miserably. You see, we study, we prep for natural tests, and we study and prep for natural challenges, and we don't expect to be promoted when we fail those. Why would it be any different with God when it comes to eternal matters? We cannot expect to fail the test that God sends our way and get promoted. If you're struggling with the same thing again and again, if you're repeating the same cycles in your life, you're going through the same issues, you're dealing with the same problems, you're fighting the same habits, the same things repeat themselves in your relationships, in your emotions, in your ministry, in your church attendance, in your business, and they come up again and again, maybe you're not passing the test. And instead of asking God to get you out of the circumstance, ask him to help you pass the test so that you don't have to go through it again. God will cycle you back around until you've passed the test. I remember there was one year in the ministry where I was just so very discouraged. And I was to that point, and I know you've been there too, where you're trying to guilt God into a response. You know, you're saying things like, Lord, don't you see me? God, can't you hear me? God, are you there? And you know he's there. You're just trying to make him feel bad. And I remember I said something so foolish, and I'm just being very open with you. I like to be very transparent with the viewers because you guys can see authenticity anyway. And I remember I told the Lord, because it was a financial hardship we had faced, and I was so tired of going through that financial hardship. Every year around the same time of the year, our ministry would just out of nowhere take a hit financially and dive. And I couldn't figure out why it was. And finally, I was so fed up, I was so frustrated, I felt like my backup was up against the wall. I know you've been there, you feel like there's no options, you're looking for a way out, and you can't see how things are possibly gonna get any better. And I said, Lord, and again, I spoke very foolishly, do not say this, but this is what I said. I said, Lord, if you don't come through, I have to quit the ministry. Of course, I spoke that out of frustration, and I'll never forget what I heard back in my spirit. The Lord said, then quit. Now, some Christians are going to say, that wasn't God, that wasn't the Holy Spirit. Well, you have to understand that God deals with people of different maturities in different ways. He likely deals with you. Most of our viewers, there are people who are hungry for more of God, and you may have known the harshness with which God can speak sometimes. Though he is loving, he corrects and he chastises those whom he loves. And he spoke it very sharply, just then go ahead. And his point was to humble me. God knew I needed humbling. And I remember nothing came of that prayer, and I just continued in the ministry despite what had happened. Then the next year, the same issue came up. And very foolishly, I spoke those same words again in the same season. And this time the Lord didn't say, then quit. You know what the Lord told me? He said, you just caused yourself to go through another year of the same test. And it shook me. Yeah, I know. That's intense. The Lord said, you just bought yourself another year. And it shocked me what God had spoken. Sure enough, another year of struggle like that came through until I was pressured to the point, and that time I responded differently, and since then we've had breakthrough financially. But I bought myself another year because I failed to pass the test. So now let's continue looking at the test. There's number one, the test of being misunderstood. Number two, the test of service. And number three is found in Genesis chapter 37, verse 18 through 28. We see, and I'll just tell you what happens for the sake of time. You can read it later. That's Genesis 37, 18 through 28. We see that Joseph's brothers see him coming, and they say, oh, here comes the dreamer. They're mocking him. They're mocking the dream within him. And they take him, and they sell him into slavery. You know this story. That's number three, the test of betrayal. Those who should be loyal to you often will turn. Look, it happened to Jesus. It happened to Paul. If it happened to the greatest men of God in the Bible, it's going to happen to you and I. The scripture talks about people going through betrayal. Now, you have to guard your heart, because when you are betrayed, you can grow bitter. When you are betrayed, you can feel a righteous or so-called righteous indignation to talk bad, to downplay, to degrade someone's character. And that's not what God wants you to do. You have to face betrayal if you're going to be Christ-like. So number three, the test of betrayal. Then number four, let's read Genesis chapter 39, verse 1 through 2. And this is after Joseph's in slavery for a while. Or he had just been sold into slavery. The scripture says this: when Joseph was taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelite traders, he was purchased by Potiphar, an Egyptian officer. Potiphar was captain of the guard for Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. The Lord was with Joseph, so he succeeded in everything he did as he served in the home of his Egyptian master. So number one, the test of being misunderstood. Number two, the test of service. Number three, the test of betrayal. And then we see that Joseph, despite the discouraging circumstance, serves. Number four, the test of discouragement. You know, persistence doesn't even begin until you feel like you've given all you have. Persistence doesn't even begin until you feel like quitting. When all of your energy, your emotion, your resource, and your effort is exhausted, then persistence kicks in. People think they're being persistent when they face a little opposition and keep going. No. Persistence comes when you've given all that you know how to give, when you've emptied yourself of all that you have and keep going. Persistence doesn't even begin until you've given all that you've had. And Joseph, in this discouraging circumstance, could have turned. He could have changed his attitude. He could have become bitter. He could have become frustrated and angry. He could have said, I shouldn't even be here. I'm called of God. I have destiny. I have dreams. I'm special. I have favor. He could have said all of that. But instead of letting his favor cause him to become an entitled person, instead of letting the favor of God give him a sense of entitlement, it gave him encouragement in the times of discouragement. Joseph decided that no matter what I face, no matter where I am, no matter what comes against me, no matter how bad it looks, I'm going to serve. I'm going to do what's right. I'm going to keep going. And this is what he did. He kept going when he was in slavery. He kept going when things looked the worst. Can you imagine? He goes from being a favored son to being thrown into a pit to serving a man named Potiphar. And he's a slave. But he kept serving. He kept doing what was right. He kept being excellent in not so excellent times. See, often we look at our surroundings and say, God, get me out of here. God, I deserve better. God, I'm... And we try to blame the chaos on what's happening outside of us when really the chaos is what's going on inside. Joseph experienced inner peace in times of outer chaos, and eventually that took the times of outer chaos into times of outer peace. But if you surrender your inner peace, then the chaos gets inside of you. It's possible to be in a storm without having the storm be in you. And that's what Joseph did. He said, though I'm in the dark times, though I'm in darkness, darkness will not be in me. I will be light in the darkness instead of letting it consume me. He didn't grow discouraged. He didn't settle down. You know, some of us, and let me just get real with you. Some of us, we're serving in the ministry and we're becoming discouraged, and you're so discouraged that you don't put as much quality work that you used to put into your sermons. You don't put your best foot forward. You're not trying as hard as you used to try. And now you're going through the motions and it looks like you're staying consistent, but really you've allowed discouragement to take away from the quality of what you're supposed to do for God. And because discouragement has taken from the quality, it's also taken from the excellence and therefore the favor that should take you to the next step. Some of us just go through the motions and expect God to reward it. But if you're just going through the motions and not doing the best that you can with where you are and with what you have, you cannot expect for God to take you to the next level. Joseph, despite the circumstances, allowed heavenly excellence, the culture of the king, to flow through who he was. You have to pass this test of discouragement. Are you always finding yourself discouraged? Perhaps you're just repeating the test again and again. You see, it's not just going through something that God rewards. It's going through something with a good attitude. See, you could face a trial with a bad attitude and not be promoted and expect this sense of entitlement. Lord, I went through the trial. I went through the trial. You should promote me. But God says, no, it was your attitude in the trial that caused you to fail the test. And then you'll do good for 6 months, 9 months, even a year maybe, and then want the blessing now. Give it to me now, Lord. We want instant gratification. Not realizing that those who are blessed, that those who succeed, that those who go to the next level are people who all felt like quitting at one point. Let me tell you something. Don't quit. Keep going. Do not let yourself be discouraged. Pass that test. Then in chapter 39, verse 3 through 20, And many of you know the story of Joseph. We see that Joseph is serving in Potiphar's house. Eventually, the excellence with which he's serving causes him to become in charge of all of Potiphar's responsibilities. And Potiphar's wife takes a liking to Joseph. Now, in this season of his life, Joseph, from the outside looking in, seemed as though he was blessed. Think about it. He had good food. He had good clothes. He had influence. In fact, it's quite possible that Joseph could have thought that living in Potiphar's house was the fulfillment of the dream. Sometimes we'll get to a place where things are pretty good and we'll want to settle down. But Potiphar's wife took a liking to Joseph and tried to have sex with him. And Joseph, being a man of integrity, a man of God, pulls away. When he pulls away, she takes his robe. And then she goes to Potiphar and says, look it, he tried to enslave me. He tried to have his way with me, and I fought him off, and now I have his robe. Now, I find it interesting that Joseph wasn't put to death. I think Potiphar believed Joseph, not his wife. But how do you respond when doing the right thing seems to put you in the wrong place? This test, the fifth test, is the test of blessings. Sometimes God will put good things in your hands to see if you'll settle. It is in the times of success that we become most vulnerable to the attacks of the enemy. It is when we are most blessed that we are most vulnerable. We let our guard down. We relax. We start to enjoy where we are. Quality starts to suffer. We're not as desperate anymore. We're not as hungry to do something for God because we're blessed. The test of blessings, Joseph passed it because he kept his integrity even in the times of blessing. Let me ask you something. Have you settled in the house of Potiphar? I wonder how many people have settled for their first round of blessings, held on to it, not given it up, and missed out on the ultimate destiny that God had for them. I wonder how many people held on to something smaller when God had something greater for them, and they never received the greater because they were satisfied with the smaller. Joseph was not satisfied in the house of Potiphar enough to give up his integrity. He passed the test of blessings. Isn't it funny that we're on our face before God in desperate times, praying in tongues, just seeking the Lord, and then all of a sudden, once we're blessed, we kind of back off? Could it be that God disrupts our comforts so that we can pray? Could it be that God removes things from our lives so that we will seek His face? And if so, why does He have to do that? Because we do not pass the test of blessing. You're settling for Potiphar when God has promised the palace. You're settling for what you have now because you're comfortable and you're not willing to give it up. It's interesting that when Joseph did the right thing, he was sent to prison. But I find it even more interesting that prison was a promotion. Now, from the outside of it, it looked like in Joseph's mind that he's going backwards. In his mind, if I was Joseph, I would have thought, wow, I'm serving the Lord, and this seems to be a setback. But what you think is a setback just might be a divine setup. You say, God, this is the enemy setting me back. But God says, no, this is me setting you up. Your divine setbacks are actually divine setups. The prison seemed to be a worse place, but the prison was the step right before the palace. Things will get worse just before the greatest blessing. Times will be toughest just before the biggest promotions. Just when you think that you're facing the worst things that you have ever faced, know that it's because the greatest blessings are just around the corner. That's not cliche. That's not rhetoric. That is truth. That when you're facing the darkest times, God has the brightest blessing shining before you on the other side. What waits for you on the other side of the prison is the palace. Now, you may look at your circumstance. You may say, I did the right thing, God. I was blessed and I did the right thing and I seem to have lost it all. But you need to know that when you pass the test of blessings, God removes those blessings, not just to take them from you, but so that he can give you the real thing. God will give you a test of blessing before he gives you the fruit of the actual blessing. And you may be saying, God, I did the right thing. I'm serving you. I'm doing everything you asked me to do. Why is everything falling apart? It's because you're being promoted. You may say, God, why are things seeming like they're setting back? It's because you're being promoted. Why are things getting worse? It's because you're one step away now from the palace. You look at your circumstance, you say, God, I don't see how this is better, but you do. If I was Joseph, I would not have seen how the prison was better than Potiphar's house, but it was just another step in the journey past the test of blessings. Now, number 6, verse 39, or chapter 39, let's go there, and let's read verse 21 through 23. Verse 21 through 23. But the Lord was with Joseph in the prison and showed him his faithful love. And the Lord made Joseph a favorite with the prison warden. Even there, he's letting his light shine and he's promoted. Before long, the warden put Joseph in charge of all the other prisoners and over everything that happened in the prison. The warden had no more worries because Joseph took care of everything. The Lord was with him and caused everything he did to succeed. Number 6 is the test of faithfulness. Now, faithfulness is not just doing something consistently. Faithfulness is doing something consistently with excellence. Faithfulness cannot be had in days, cannot be had in weeks, cannot be had in months. Faithfulness is measured in years. It takes a long time to be faithful. Now, I know not a lot of people like to hear that. But the truth is that it's going to take some time to process you before God will promote you. That's the truth. And if you're still fighting God on how long it's taking, I mean, I remember there was a time where I said, Lord, no, I should be doing more right here, right now. Lord, I should be here. I should be there. And I would measure myself up against the ministries that I admired and the men of God who I learned from. And I said, Lord, I should be there. I should be there. I should be there. And it wasn't until I said, Lord, help me to pass the test where I am right now. I learned to say, Lord, just process me. Take the time. Process me. It's like building a building. If you rush the foundation, it doesn't matter how tall you build. The whole thing's going to collapse anyway. So you have to let him build and process your foundation now before he begins to erect the structure. Because if you don't allow him to work on the foundation through times of faithfulness, then when you finally are blessed, you'll crumble under the pressure. So now I say, Lord, take as much time as you need. I'm okay. My mindset went from thinking in days, weeks, and months to now I plan in years and I pray in years and I think in years. And because of that, God has been with me every step of the way. And I want to encourage you in the same thing. Don't rush that. If you are bothered by the fact that it takes time, if you in your mind are trying to work around how you might be different, how that you might be so special that you don't have to wait as much, then that goes to show you haven't passed the test first. You haven't passed the test of service. You're still back on that one. Once you're okay with, and you got to be real with yourself. Once you're genuinely okay with, Lord, take your time and I'm on your pace. What's the rush anyway? What are we in a hurry for? I don't believe Jesus ever rushed. I just, the more I look at the Bible, the less I see anyone hurrying. And if I'm in a hurry, it means I'm in the wrong mindset. It means I'm in the wrong heart or I'm not organized. Hurry is not a trait of the godly. And so once you've stopped the hurry, once you've slowed the pace, you know that you've matured to the point where you can start thinking in a way that God can bless you. Pass the test of faithfulness. Don't hurry. Don't rush. Just do what's before you. Do well in what you are doing right now. I'm not saying don't have a vision. I'm not saying don't have a plan. I'm not saying don't have a dream. Joseph had a dream, but he didn't let the dream of what was to come affect him where he was. He didn't let the dream of what he knew he should have make him feel entitled to where he didn't have to be faithful in the prison. Be faithful in the prison. Be faithful in the tough times. Be faithful when nobody knows your name. Be faithful when you don't have a platform from which you can speak. Be faithful when you haven't started anything and you're frustrated by it. Be faithful and be encouraged. God is with you in the prison. God's going to promote you. God's going to bless you. But in his timing, once you've yielded to that, it actually makes things go a lot quicker. Rushing slows down the process of the call. When you take your time, it actually moves things along quicker because it's in cooperation with God. And finally, in chapter 40, verse 1 through 19, we see that Joseph meets the cupbearer and the baker. And if you're not familiar with the story, go and read it. Pause the video. Genesis 40, verse 1 through 19, we see that Joseph in the prison meets a cupbearer and a baker. They both have dreams. He interprets them. He says to the cupbearer, oh, you're going to be released here in, I believe it was 3 days. And then to the baker, the baker goes, oh, give me a word. And he says, well, you're going to die in 3 days. You're going to be hanged. And so, you know, he gives these words and he tells the cupbearer, hey, look, you're going to go back and be restored as Pharaoh's cupbearer. You're going to go back and you're going to serve him. You're going to go back and be reconnected with him. But when you go before Pharaoh, remember me. He's basically saying, tell him about who I am. Get me out of here. The cupbearer says, okay. But the scripture says that the cupbearer was released before Joseph. Now, that's the seventh test. It's the test of jealousy. What do you do? How do you respond? And how do you feel when others receive that which you've been praying for? How do you treat someone who has what you want? More importantly, how do you treat someone who's put in less time than you and gets what you've been waiting for? The cupbearer was not in prison. In fact, Joseph saw the cupbearer come in and watched him go. If I was Joseph, I'm just being honest with you, and I'm being transparent. If I was Joseph, I would have said, Lord, I've been here longer than him. How come he's getting promoted out of the prison first? Because God wants to test you. Let whoever is around you, they have their own journey with God. God wants to process you. You don't know how many times in my own mind, when my flesh gets the better of me, I've looked at things and I said, Lord, why did you promote that person when they barely started in ministry? Why are they preaching at those conferences? And the Holy Spirit will rebuke me. And this was years ago, I was thinking like this because I was frustrated with where we were. And the Lord said, you run your own race. You have to pass this test. And how you treat those who have what you want, or how you view those. Some of us, and let me tell you, I've heard pastors speak against other pastors. I've heard ministries speak against me. I've heard people speak against me and other pastors. I mean, the gossip just goes every which way. And it's funny how the pastors such as Joel Osteen get the biggest criticism. Do you know why they do? Because people are jealous of what he has. Because they're jealous that he has influence on the world. He's actually changing culture, and they're not. I'm just going to call it like it is. They're jealous because here's a man being promoted who's faithful to God, and everyone just wants to criticize, oh, he doesn't preach enough this, doesn't preach enough, but it's not true. God's using him where he needs to be right now, and God's doing through Joel Osteen what needs to be done. I use him, of course, as an example. But you need to stop talking bad about people who have what you want. You need to stop trying to downplay the success that God has given to others. You do it because of the jealousy in your heart, and we need to repent of that. Otherwise, God won't promote you. I'll say it again. You need to stop being jealous of other ministers, of other business, whatever it is you want someone else has, stop being jealous, stop being bitter. Stop talking to people in a way that degrades them. Funny, I've seen it. People will go and they'll talk about someone and they feel better saying, well, he has a big church, but that's just people from other churches that go to his church now. And they, for some reason, that makes them feel better about what they have. That's jealousy. We could spiritualize it all we want. It's jealousy. And it needs to be repented of. So that's number 7. Then number 8 is the test of hiddenness. We see in chapter 40, verse 20 through 41 through verse 1, that Joseph was in the prison for 2 more years. That cupbearer forgot all about Joseph, and Joseph was in there for 2 years. Now here's Joseph with a gift to serve in a high capacity, and he's in a prison. Joseph has all of the excellence to serve in the high command, and he's instead a prisoner. Number 8, you're going to have to go through seasons where you're hidden. where it seems like God tucks you away in a corner and forgets about you. He doesn't, but he does this as a test. Do you feel overlooked? Do you feel like you're not given your chance? You feel like you're perfect for something and you're just not given the opportunity? Good. That is the test of hiddenness. And if you can keep your heart right when God hides you, then you'll remain humble when he promotes you. And finally, number 9, Joseph stands before Pharaoh and he interprets the dream and he just very clearly lays it out. This is what God says. But it took faith to do that. Number 9 is this test of faith. You cannot step into the next realm of your destiny unless you have faith. If you're going to go where God wants you to go, you're going to step there by faith. You know, a word that is often synonymous with faith is the word risk. Have you stepped out? Have you done something radical? Have you done something different? Have you done something counterintuitive? What's God asking you to do? We wait, we sit back, and we pass all 8 of the tests, but it's going to do you no good to pass all the other 8 tests and then fail the test of faith and not step out and do something. My brother, my sister, I want to urge you, pass your tests and then step out in faith. Are you afraid? Are you weary? Are you worrisome? Are you apprehensive about what could possibly happen when you obey God? Good. That means it takes faith to do what you're supposed to do. So Lord, I pray, help us to realize when we're being tested. And more importantly, Lord, help us to pass those tests. I pray, God, that blessing and promotion would come as we obey your word, as we live in your favor, and as we do what we're called to do. We thank you, Father, for our brothers and sisters. Lord, we bless those who have what we want. We bless those who have what we believe is rightfully ours. Lord, we pray, help us to slow down all of these areas, Lord, help us. Now I'm going to pray that God's Spirit would just come on you afresh. Come on, stretch your hands toward mine in faith. Lord, in Jesus' name, let the gentle breeze of the Holy Spirit's presence move across the room. Let them sense your divine touch. Let them sense your nearness. Father, I pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to flow, to touch each one watching. Touch that one watching, Lord. Encourage them, infuse them with power from on high. We thank you, Lord. Lord, forgive us for not passing our tests. And help us to pass them in times to come. We thank you, Lord, for second chances, that your mercies are new every morning. We thank you for your mercy. Remove the guilt, remove the shame, remove the frustration. And let us move forward with faith as we walk into our divine destiny. In Jesus' name we pray, and you said, amen. Well, as usual, I want to now encourage you to make a gift to this ministry. If you're blessed by what we do here, or you're a member of Spirit Church, I encourage you, sow into this ministry. Do something today. I really need people to begin sowing so that we can continue to grow. People have been sowing, and we've experienced more growth. We're able to do more for the Lord now. And we have big things coming. You'll be hearing about them soon. By the way, if you watch this before November 21st, 2015, I want you to know we have a benefit dinner coming up for the ministry. And at that dinner, I'm going to be making a very big announcement for the ministry. You don't want to miss it. There's only about 50 seats available left for that dinner. Register now. Also, August 30th, I'll be in Orange, California, one night, a Sunday night at 7 o'clock. I really feel that God is going to do something very special at this event. I want you to do whatever you have to do to be there. I don't care if you have to drive down, fly down, cancel some other events, get down to this service. The Holy Spirit's presence is going to visit us in a powerful way. I just know it. That's August 30th at 1200 West Alvarez in Orange, California. For more information on that, you can visit DavidHernandezMinistries.com/EncounterOC. Again, make your gifts. Help us sponsor these events. Help us sponsor what we're doing for the Lord. We can continue to grow, expand, touch the world, and souls need saving. That's why we do it. We do it for someone's eternity. Well, that's it for this edition of Spirit Church. Until next time, I want you to remember this. And this is not just a cliche. It's not just a saying. I want you to really believe this, know this, let it settle in your heart. Nothing is impossible with God.